23rd of August.
Was that something new? I don't recall. It's about 500.
Michigan, yeah.
It's just starting, or?
Well, it's been, what, I guess 5 years. Oh, Pocono, there's a triple crime.
Pocono, Pennsylvania.
It's the second biggest race we have of the year. And it's a good race. It's live televised and things like that. It's a big race.
There was something I wanted to tell you, and that was Meadowlands Grand Prix in the summertime. I had won that race, and it was the same time that the hostages had come home, and you came over and told everybody that the hostages were released and so on and so forth. And that was right when I was giving my talk for the TV to a victory deal. So I just wanted to say that. Only
and I was
Mr. President.
I was doing the cutter work on television.
That's great. Good stuff. We're going to do that other thing.
Okay.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. President. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, David.
It's been an honor. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
It's really been an honor to work with you.
Well, listen, I'm pleased to have had you, and I thank you for everything, but I'm not going to say goodbye to you. Just
that's right. I'm going across the street, and I'm really pleased about it. Working with Jim Miller is going
to
be great.
Here's a little thing to hold paper. Yes.
Thank you very much. It's been an honor. Thank you.
This is Dr. Majidi, and he represents the Afghan fighters. And his brother is the head of one of the principal factions, but he's here for all
of them. Dr. Majidi. Yes, sir.
Gulerenge?
Yes, Gulerenge.
Yes, sir. From his brand, he was bombarding. And he was in the bit, drinking with a few of them. But he got the back. Very good.
Hello.
Thank you for coming.
I have a question, but I don't know if I'm not going to thank you for that. This is your thing to hear. Mr. Hassan,
yes.
From Northern Syria. We lost one of the people due to bombardment. Yes, he's a little bit shy with his new sticks. Did Shafiwa lost?
Dennis Lepin
also lost his hand in the capital of Kabul. Bombardment. Shafiwa? Yes, salam alaikum. Not yet. All due to bombardment.
Salam alaikum.
This is the father of Gur Ranga, from Kunduz. This is the book. From Gur Ranga. And this is also one of the Afghan casket, which they have brought for years in memory. This is from the northern area.
Oh, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm very pleased to have that.
Mr. President, we'll do a group photo here with the children.
Yeah, let me go get them on the bed. Look at that. Yeah, should I be inside or?
Steve, can I get in the center here? Yes.
This please you better.
Thank you, sir.
This must end. It must end with the Soviet Union withdrawing its forces.
Mr. President, may I was going to introduce Dr. Kramer, who is the other medical staff that have helped the children.
This is Denise Tompkins, Mr. President. She's from the Shriners Burn Institute in Boston. They've been reconstructing this little girl's face. She's the chief nurse there. And I'd like to meet one of our members.
Hello.
Sharon Wilcox, who takes these children into her home and takes care of them. This is Charles Bracunier.
Yes, thank you.
He's the
honor
to meet you, Mr. President. He's the very president.
He's the wheel horse of our organization, goes into Afghanistan on a regular basis if he doesn't get shot at, which he has been on two occasions, and reports to Senator Humphrey's Packwood.
God bless you all for what you're doing. As I say, all of us together, let's see if this stops.
Now that's what we'll
do everything we can to bring it to an end.
I would like to thank you on behalf of my people in the Afghan Mission Fund that you've given us this opportunity to meet you here and giving your time, valuable time, to see the victim of Russians in Afghanistan, these small children. We are pleased of this time, and I would like to mention that to convey the message of our people that to stop such victims, I think it's very much essential to send us to defense against air attack of Russian and to send us missiles to stop these gunship helicopters demolishing our villages, civilians, and these children. So also, I would like to convey that we need our food, we need our to have medical supplies, and as well as we need other political support in our affairs. So I would like to thank the Freedom Alliance that they have arranged this program, that they have brought these children, and they have especially bring to you that you have seen, and to the people of the United States. And we hope you could, by the help of Your Excellency and the committee, you could extend this program. Thank you very much.
Mr. Bracunier, I think you should tell you the magnitude of the children problem.
Even as we meet here in the Oval Office, children in Afghanistan are dying as a result of Soviet air attacks and artillery bombardments on their villages. But the Soviets are waging a war against the Afghan civilian population. Here are five children, burned, without arms, without legs. They represent, they symbolize more than 100,000 children in Afghanistan who have either been killed or have been badly maimed by the Soviet attacks. And so we appeal actually to President Gorbachev as well. If he is a man of peace, if he is a man that we can do business with, if he will never start a war, let him show by his example in 1986 in Afghanistan, let him end the Soviet-Afghan war and stop killing and maiming these children.
Thank you, Mr. President. I should be invited to my discussions with Secretary General Gorbachev.
All right. Well,
thank you all.
Thank you once again. It's been a great day for us.
Thanks.
This is also a chance to the chief company to follow
the okay.
Also, I also want to thank the chief on this one. As a matter of fact, been there and we've been on that first trip to that doctor and I've been on that phone. My wife said, you know, it's okay to turn
this story.
I said, you don't have the president match your flag. She said, I thought we were so good at all.
Because a lot of pictures that I took in Afghanistan. Or something.
Okay, Mr. President, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, Don, Jim,
Robert.
You all set?
I'm ready.
Good practice. What's going on, Ray?
I don't know where I was. Hello, Dick.
Well, they're just with their face just a mass, eyes just a little white thing. This was the purpose of bombing. They're all bombing. They're in the new constitutions. Just one arm of the prosthesis on there now, instead of the arm. And then one little girl, father, who didn't cover. And hers is a leg. It's completely gone. There's all the bombings.
I think it's the same kind of publicity that our criticism of bombings got.
Yes.
Let me ask you a very specific question. I want to give you more time. Dick will be with me this weekend. The other morning at breakfast, I asked you about value-added taxes, consumption taxes, and you said no, that's fine. I lighted up your position, and it gives me a lot of good, strong backbone when I go to meet with financial companies. Without, I can have it as my talking. I think that'll end it. You were a little more indefinite. Senator Domenici asked you about an oil import fee. And I don't want to put words in your mouth one way or the other, but I need to know how much wiggle room I've got. And that was something that was in your budget a couple of years ago, $10 oil import fee.
Well, here's why I had to. I was out of the spot.
Oh, I know. Everyone, listen.
I feel that to give in advance, well, then that reduces any leverage that we would have or that you would have with regard to getting back some of the things that the House Ways and Means Committee put in that we find offensive and we want changed, and yet it means we're going to have to find revenue from something else. I think that it's a case of fighting as hard as we can to get those changes made. And then the end result, to get those principal things, if it takes a tax, but consistent, however, with tax neutrality.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. That would be a trade-off for basically lower rates and capital formation.
Then, but to open in advance, say, yes, I would agree with this, well, then we've lost all our leverage, and we're not going to get the things changed we want changed.
Well, I'll tell you what I'm going to try to do, and Dick and Jim estimate that we need about $100 billion to undo the things, at least if I look at your chart, that the House has done. I'm going to try to put together a couple.
Thank you all for coming on such short notice. Appreciate your concern and interest in the budget and what we're doing about federal budget deficits. I hope I'm not going to plow any ground here in the next few minutes. That's all we've been plowing about this. I just would like to, I know you've been briefed in detail on that 87 budget proposal. I'd like to add to the discussion a little bit. I think that 86 is a year of decision. It's the year to decide whether we have the will to at last bring federal spending under control and remove the last remaining obstacle to a future of growth and prosperity. It's the year to decide whether we can make the tough decisions that we agreed to last year when the Graham-Rudman-Hollings legislation became law. It's the year to make clear to the world that our commitment to peace through strength will not be compromised. And it's the year to maintain our continued opposition to raising taxes, which could harm the economy and take money away from Americans in order to protect government programs that we don't need and can't afford. Today, deficit reduction is the law of the land. Graham Rudman Hollings mandates a declining deficit path, leading to a balanced budget in fiscal year 1991. As I just told some other people over the EOB a little while ago, and that's the dream moment, at which point there should go into effect an amendment that says the federal government can't borrow anymore, that it's going to have to stick within its income. So the deficit will be cut, and the big question is, how? The automatic spending cuts in that legislation are triggered only if Congress abdicates its constitutional responsibility and fails to pass a budget that meets the deficit targets. In other words, Congress still has a choice. It can be responsible by making those careful and sometimes difficult spending decisions, or it can simply drop the ball and let the across-the-board cuts take over, which I don't think is any way to run a ball game. The budget that will soon be submitted to Congress was carefully prepared, taking into account our defense needs, proper role of government, and the deficit targets. And it will meet the fiscal year 1987 deficit target of $144 billion without harming the economy through a tax increase and compromising our national security. It'll preserve the safety net for those truly in need, and it will not penalize older Americans by reducing the Social Security benefits. Now, as I'm sure Cap and Jim probably mentioned, our budget will include a modest increase in defense to sustain the recent improvements in capability. Some will say that's too much for defense, but the proposed funding levels for national security in our budget are consistent with the real growth path that was agreed to by myself and the Congress last year. Higher taxes are no cure for the deficit. Reducing the deficit through tax hikes would impose substantial new tax burdens on American households, and as experience has proved, would reduce incentives for Americans to work and save and invest, and thus choking off the creation of new jobs. And experience has also shown that higher taxes don't necessarily go to reduce the deficit. More often, they are used to justify increased government spending. Current economic expansion is well into its fourth year, and over 9 million new jobs have been brought on our way to lasting prosperity. So the budget that we're sending to Congress on February 4th will put us on the right track to a balanced budget by 1991. It'll reduce the deficit while promoting economic growth and meeting our national security requirements. We've made the tough decisions around this table, so now it's time to see if Congress is up to the challenge of passing a responsible budget. And it all comes down to what I'm talking about is I'll need your help, and I'll encourage all of you to make your views known. I know it's going to be a tough battle, but I think together we can reduce the deficit and set America on a path to permanent prosperity. That's enough for me. I'd like to hear from you now. What did you have to say?
Mr. President, my name is Bob Kilpatrick. It's awful hard to express a view that's different than yours, because I think the business